As adults, we will talk among ourselves about last night's verdict in the George Zimmerman trial. But as we look forward, we're also going to have to grapple with what we're going to say to our children.
My kids are teenagers. I am more afraid for the boys than I am for my daughter. Because everywhere they go, everything that they're wearing, their demeanor, the way they walk, are they looking at you funny? Everything about them is supposed to be suspicious. And they're tiny, skinny, little kids that to me are babies.
I used to tell my boys, you know, don't run because they may think you're suspicious. Well, actually, now I have to say don't walk slowly because that also means that you may be suspicious. We have to figure out what is the pace for which a black man can walk in America and be beyond suspicion.
Whether or not white folks believe the verdict was valid, or whether black folks believe the verdict was valid, putting the legal issues aside, there is the simple truth that in the wake of this incident, even before the trial, and certainly after the trial, black families all across this country, and indeed Latino families and just families of color generally, are having a very different conversation, by and large, with their children, particularly their male children, than white families are. And that's not because those black families assume that everyone who's not black is out to get them or that Latinos think everyone who's not Latino is out to get them. It's because we know, or at least they do, that these racial biases, these presumptions of criminality are so deeply ingrained that they can trigger prejudiced, biased, even racist reactions in people who otherwise might be decent folks. Might trigger them in cops who are otherwise decent, might trigger them in neighborhood watch wannabe cops like George Zimmerman, might trigger them in teachers who overreact and suspend or expel their kids out of a class or a school in ways we know they don't as readily with white students. White parents around this country, in the wake of this incident in February of last year and in the wake of the verdict, are not sitting their male children down and telling them, you know what? Don't go anywhere where they don't know you, and don't wear a hoodie, and walk at a deliberate pace, and don't look like you're looking at anything because someone's going to call the cops or they might shoot you. That conversation is not happening. And if white folks can just understand what that means, if we can begin to understand what it means for black moms and dads to tell their male children when they're stopped by police that they have to keep their hands at 10 and 2, that if they're going to reach for their wallet to get their license or reach for the glove box to get their registration, they have to say before they do it, this is what I'm doing. I'm reaching for the glove box to get my registration. I, as a white man who's been stopped by cops on several occasions for speeding or whatever, never, ever, ever thought twice about reaching for the glove box, never thought twice about reaching, you know, my back pocket to get my wallet, never thought twice, and was never told by my parents that I needed to worry about that. If white folks learn nothing else, understand or try to understand the fundamental difference, and it is rooted in racial experience and a history of racism, between being black and being white and trying to raise children to healthy adulthood, because that is perhaps the biggest lesson that I think we can take away from this incident and this case.